Steve is like the coolest name for an Aurora. Why would you like come up with a backronym and just ruin it? Its name is Steve. Don't make it try and stand for something. So cast your mind back to like late 2015, early 2016. At that time, there were some Aurora watchers in Canada, in Alberta, that had been seeing this type of Aurora that they'd never really seen before, but it was particularly spectacular, so they were taking lots of images of it. And it was this sort of long, thin, sort of whitish, purplish streak across the sky. And they were referring to that as a proton arc. So there's two different types of auroras that you could get. So the aurora are basically caused by the solar wind hitting the magnetic field of the Earth. Now the solar wind is basically when the sun gets a little bit too active and sort of burps off a load of high energy particles. Talking like protons, electrons, charged particles that when they hit the magnetic field of the Earth, they get sort of funneled down to the poles. Then they hit elements in the Earth's atmosphere and interact with them. So in a normal aurora that you see in all those greens and reds, that's when an electron hits into an atom in the Earth's atmosphere, causes the electron around the outside of that atom to jump up to the next energy level, drop down, and then give out light. And that light is always the exact same wavelength because quantum mechanics says that those electron levels that electrons are found in around atoms can only be at very, very specific energies. So the energy difference is always the same. So the wavelength is always the same. So that you always get the same exact color. So oxygen will give off red high up in the atmosphere. Nitrogen will give off sort of a bluish kind of a color. Oxygen in the lower atmosphere gives off like a green light, and then N2, which is like nitrogen molecules, so two atoms of nitrogen together, gives off kind of a pinkish glow. And so all those normal aurora are caused by electrons hitting the atmosphere. But what the Alberta aurora chasers were referring to this kind of aurora as was proton arcs. So a proton arc would be something that instead of being caused by electrons hitting atoms in the Earth's atmosphere, it would be protons hitting electrons in the Earth's atmosphere. So the Alberta chasers then went to like a conference about aurora and actually met with an expert, Professor Donovan, when they were there, and showed him some of their images that they'd taken of these aurora and said, oh, these are these proton arcs you've been seeing. But the first thing that Professor Donovan said was that they couldn't possibly be proton arcs because proton interactions in the Earth's atmosphere don't actually emit wavelengths that we can actually see with our own eyes. They're actually much lower in wavelengths because protons are heavier, so they don't get accelerated as much, and so they don't impart as much energy when they collide with an ion in the Earth's atmosphere, and so they give out longer wavelength of light, like in the infrared, that we can't actually see. So he said there's no way that it could be a proton arc because we wouldn't be able to see it if it was, and those things are also more diffuse. He also said, though, he'd never seen anything like this before, and he'd been studying aurora for decades. That was when the aurora chasers then decided to call this thing a different name so that they could refer to it as something else instead of a proton arc, and they chose Steve. And the reason they chose Steve was after the animated kids comedy Over the Hedge, when one of the characters in Over the Hedge comes across something he's not familiar with and he doesn't know what to call it and he's scared of it, so he gives it a name so he becomes less scared of it, and he calls things that he's scared of Steve. So they picked the same reason. They had no idea what it was, so they were like, let's call it Steve. And it turns out Steve actually is quite a common phenomenon. I mean, it's not rare at all. It's just that no one really knew to look for it before. You know, if you'd seen it in the sky before and you weren't an expert, you wouldn't have necessarily known that it wasn't a known phenomenon. You wouldn't know that it hadn't been ID'd before, and you wouldn't know to like report it necessarily. And then who also would you report it to? So Professor Donovan said that, you know, this discovery probably wouldn't have been possible pre-2016 just because of the advent of social media meant that groups like the Alberta Aurora Chasers could organize themselves, post images, report what they'd seen, and also report when an aurora is going to be visible to people across the globe and across Canada as well. And the way that experts had been doing it before was setting up night sky cameras, but those were expensive. There was only one or two across Canada sort of like a decade ago, whereas now there's a lot more as well. And also you have all of these citizen scientists basically also reporting where they'd seen aurora, at what location and what time exactly as well. So with all this new information that was communicated over social media by these citizen scientists, it meant that the professional astronomers could then take that information and actually say, okay, well, did we have a satellite that was flying over that part of the world at that time that may have actually passed through one of these Steve features? So one of the first groups to look at this was Professor Donovan's group in 2018. The paper was by Gallardo, McCourt and their collaborators, and they had a March 2018 event over Canada where Steve had appeared that they had a satellite go above it, not through it, but above it. And what they found was actually there was no particles raining down on the atmosphere at any point during when Steve had been seen. So if you've got Aurora, you kind of need the charged particles raining on the atmosphere to produce it, but it hadn't detected anything like that at all. So that suggested that actually Steve wasn't an aurora at all, and that actually they sort of dubbed it a sky glow, even though they didn't know what that actually was yet. So as of last year, Steve has only ever been seen at the same time as Aurora, but it's actually seen further south than Aurora tend to be as well. Like, it's seen actually in the UK much further south than the typical Aurora in the very sort of northern Arctic Circle. So it's probably something a little bit different, but we're still not sure what, because it's also seasonal. Like, you don't tend to see it between like October and February as well. So there's a lot of weird things about Steve. Then later in the year, Professor Donovan's group got another satellite through an event that had been seen again over Canada to actually fly through Steve and record what it found in terms of temperature and velocity as it went through this area of the sky. And so it flew through Steve at about 300 kilometers up in the atmosphere, which is about 185 miles or so. You know, compare that with like planes fly at like 7 miles up. So it's pretty high in the atmosphere that you find this thing. And it found a change in temperature from the atmosphere outside of Steve to the atmosphere inside of Steve of 3000 degrees centigrade, which is like 5000 odd degrees Fahrenheit. Like, it's ridiculous, the change in temperature. It was also flowing westward about 6 kilometers a second, which might not sound that fast, but the atmosphere outside of Steve was going at about 10 meters a second. So it was a very, very fast stream of these ions, these charged particles, moving very, very quickly westward in the atmosphere, about 300 kilometers up, you know, 3000 degrees warmer than the rest of the atmosphere around them. They then proposed that Steve should be called the Strong Thermal Emission Velocity Enhancement, which is a backronym, i.e. you've already named it something and then you've come up with an acronym to describe it, which NASA has now adopted as well, which makes me sad. Its name is Steve, it's not an acronym. And so despite these results, you know, we still are not entirely sure how Steve has formed, but you can actually help with understanding what Steve is. So NASA have set up one of these citizen science projects, a website called Aurorasaurus, which is also an app that you can download, where you can go on, record the time, date, and place that you saw a Steve in the sky, maybe even send a picture with it as well, so they can cross-correlate that with all of their satellite data as well. And then they should be able to get more of these instances where satellites have actually passed through a Steve in the sky, so hopefully so that we can better understand what Steve is, because at the minute we don't really have any idea. And this is great timing as well, because as I said, they're not really seen from October to February, but we're in March now. And so hopefully people will start seeing Steves again and we can get a better idea of what on earth these things are in the sky that went undiscovered for so long, because it is still an unsolved mystery. And this was released in a paper by Gallardo and LaCourte from 2018. Hey, Steven, I know looks can be deceiving, but I don't think you're an aurora now.